Well, today my conversation is with Robert Baer, who is one of the most accomplished officers in CIA history, awarded the Career Intelligence Medal. He's authored 4 New York Times bestsellers. His new book, The Fourth Man, The Hunt for a KGB Spy at the Top of the CIA and the Rise of Putin's Russia. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Yeah. Isn't Zoom a lot better than just on the phone?
Absolutely. Absolutely. But, you know, I'm a radio girl. So actually, there is some kind of weird mystique that goes on when you just hear a voice, you know?
Yeah, I don't know. I like Zoom.
Plus, I don't have to put makeup on when I do radio interviews. So it's always a perk. Well, you know, I mean, your book couldn't be more timely. I mean, we're talking espionage, intelligence, counterintelligence, spies, Russia. How did you, first of all, get into all of that? Like, what was, I'm sure you've answered the question a million times, but what was it that drew you to that?
To spying? It was a prank. I was at Berkeley at the time, and my roommate says, hey, you know, you got to get a job. You know, studying Mandarin Chinese isn't going to get you anywhere. So we were sitting down over coffee, and he said, who's going to hire you? And he said, well, the last place that's ever going to hire you is the CIA. You know, you grew up in Aspen, Colorado, and you came from a hippie family. They're never going to hire you. And I said, yeah, well, let's see. I was sure I wasn't getting it. So I called up the Federal Center. And they gave me a number, a very mysterious number in Lawndale, California, which is an auto mall.
Yeah.
And the rest is history. I got in the CIA.
That's amazing. You also wrote the New York Times bestseller, See No Evil. It was adapted into Syriana. George Clooney played you. Did you meet George Clooney? You had to have, right?
You know, I went and stayed with him in Lake Como.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
What was it like?
I wouldn't trade my life for his any day. It was just like, it was awful because you'd sit outside. He wouldn't sit outside.
Yeah.
But, I'd sit outside in the patio for breakfast, and these tour boats would come by every 5 minutes, trying to look at George Clooney's house. He was on the stop. So it's basically he only had the back of his house that he could hang out in.
I don't think about that, that aspect of it.
Or you go to a restaurant and, you know, it's a quiet, you're having a quiet lunch or dinner or whatever. And all of a sudden you leave the place. There's all these paparazzi everywhere.
Wow. That's deep. You know, your book is, I guess let's start with the Middle East, because you're kind of known as an authority on the Middle East, right? What do you think we need to know? What do we need to remember about the Middle East?
Well, the Middle East is, you know, it's, you got to remember it's a rotting Ottoman Empire, and the borders are not truly fixed. They're artificial. And then you've got a lot of people that hate people, each other in a way that we don't really understand. The Shia and the Sunni and the Saudis and the Iranians. And it's just going to be a mess forever. And if you gave me a magic wand, I wouldn't know what to do with it to fix things. Mm. And then you've got Israel in the middle of it, and it's always for them a matter of survival. I don't know. There's just no easy solution to it.
In your book, The Fourth Man, we're still looking for the fourth man, right?
We're still looking for him. And one of the reasons I wrote the book, and I was encouraged by the FBI, is throw this story out. And it's, that book is an advertisement to Russian intelligence officers. Hey, if you can put this guy in jail, he's still alive. There's a lot of money out there, and you can resettle in this country. Now, I don't know how this is being received in Moscow. I do know some Russians have told me they love the book. But that's not why I wrote it. I wrote it because I was absolutely intrigued by this story. And I was intrigued because one day I'm called up to my office, to my boss's office, who says, hey, I'm going to put 3 women in your section. And they're going to be working on a project you can't know about. Well, and I want to say, well, hey, I'm the supervisor. What do you mean I can't know about it? So, but it's the CIA. Come on. So I say, fine. And I noticed they're working on something on these air gap computers. They're called grids. And, you know, they're meeting. They can't meet in the office. They don't go to conference rooms. They go outside into the parking lot to talk. All right, this is even weird for the CIA.
Yeah.
And then 20 years later, the boss comes to me and say, hey, by the way, they were those ladies working for you were on a mole hunt, an off the books mole hunt for the most important spy in American history. And that's how I got into the book. He challenged me to see what I could do to get to the bottom of it. He's essentially a whistleblower, and the investigators who helped me on this are whistleblowers as well. This investigation goes on in the 90s, but what I now know is, as of 2 weeks ago, the FBI is still going out and asking questions. It's something they can't hide about the guy. And they're going to my sources in a very friendly way. They're saying, hey, is there something we missed?
Yeah.
And they go over the data. So because so much of this investigation was never put on paper. So the combination of this investigation that went under my nose, me, Mr. Magoo, and the FBI tells me it's very real. It's not an urban myth.
Wow. It's fascinating. It's a fascinating story. It's fast moving. And what I learned, you know, I kind of think of like one person bringing somebody down, but it takes a whole team of people working really in synchronicity to make this happen, right?
Yeah. I mean, it takes persistence. The FBI has been on this since 2005, 2006, sparing no resources. And these guys like to clear cases. They hate open cases.
Yeah.
90 days, you got to go and say, why is this case still open? You go to a supervisor. So it's in their minds, it's very real. The people in the CIA that have read this book, some of them won't even read it. They don't want to hear this. Just viciously attack the FBI. Oh, they don't know what they made mistakes in the past. They did this, they did that. But I don't buy that. They're not. Yeah. This guy isn't a ghost. There was a fourth man. He did betray probably more secrets than anybody in our history. And he was a spy beyond our wildest imagination and abilities, because he's playing a game of chess against the FBI, against the CIA spy catchers. And so every time they make a move, he makes another move. And this has been going on all these years.
Yeah, I interviewed a spy a little earlier today, a former spy a little earlier today. And he talked about, you know, making moves and counter moves, and had to kind of really coming up with the strategy and how they actually did something like that with, which was also fascinating. But what is interesting to me is who becomes a mole. Like you don't have to be anybody high up. You just have to be somebody who's probably chameleon like, right?
Well, it's not that, it's the game. There's an Italian movie that came out in 1970. Was it called a Citizen Above All Suspicion? Something like that is the Italian title. And it's the homicide detective who commits the murder and leaves evidence everywhere that he did it, but he's playing the game, and it's the ultimate game. And this does happen in espionage, because people are defective in a way that go into it. And he just said, I can beat the FBI and the CIA. And not only that, if I have the right guy, he's blackmailing the FBI. I mean, he talked to him in one phone. And he says, listen, they don't have anything on me. They're wrong about the dates. They're wrong about this. They're just wrong. And then he knew who's investigating him, and he named him to me. He says, that man is an idiot and that man is a moron. They couldn't, you know.
Yeah.
And then he says, and by the way, after all these years, I've collected, scandalous information on the FBI. And if they want to see me in court, I'm going to bring it all out.
Wow.
So he's blackmailing the FBI. That's sort of gutsy, isn't it?
That's pretty ballsy. Yeah. When you're blackmailing the FBI. When there is corruption, let's say there is corruption in the CIA, what's the standard? Like is there a way to report that in a way?
There is. I mean, there's very little, in the CIA, there's very little theft and corruption, and fabricators get caught. There's the polygraph, just the culture. People are looking at each other. It's very paranoid.
Yeah.
I've never seen people, rarely do you see people just outright stealing money. Occasionally, I mean, it's like everywhere else, you see people making up things and they get caught, or they get into personal relations that are transgressive and they have to fire them. It's probably one of the best regulated agencies in the United States. in terms of keeping track of people and keeping a record of them.
I worked, this kind of explains a lot, because I worked for a former CIA agent. Like he was involved in the radio station, bought the radio station, and talk about paranoia, like to the nth degree, like putting himself in offices next to different employees, like clearing out an employee. I couldn't figure out what he was doing at the time, but this actually, where he would go so he could hear, because the walls were real thin. So he could hear the conversations going on with like the different employees. It was a very strange thing. You have the three women in your book. Do you think women have an advantage in being a spy?
They are much more meticulous. The men are at least in this generation, are more concerned about their careers. So they go, yeah, I don't want to go to counterintelligence. You know, it's nothing ever happens. How am I going to get promoted? And in when the CIA in the 60s, where women rarely became operatives, and this didn't really happen until 80s and 90s. So they were relegated to counterintelligence, and to make up for it, they just kept track of all this stuff. They could tell you where a file was. They could tell you what was in the file. They could tell you what's missing. They could keep track of detail. And in a mole hunt, it's the detail, and women do better than men. I have no doubt about it.
Well, why would you say that, like, these highly esteemed CIA agents would, why would they jeopardize everything? Like, why would they jeopardize their whole career for this?
They're in it for the game. That's what the FBI decided. The fourth man was in it for the game. He says, I'm smarter than you. You people are all idiots. And you've dismissed my intellectual capabilities, and I'm going to show you very much revenge. I don't know where the fourth man, he was, where his career ran into problems or when he made this decision. But it's not that for the FBI, the problem is there's no money to be tracked, and there's no pictures of meeting with Russians. Because if you know how to do it, know where to meet the Russians, the FBI can't follow you. You know, I mean, you know, you can't put a large surveillance team, for instance, in Vienna, but a couple of people. But to follow somebody like this, you would need 200 people on the ground. And he knew not to make any phone calls. There's no cell phone calls. There's nothing that would tie him to Russian intelligence.
And it's in the title of the book. Why didn't we do anything to stop the rise of Putin's Russia? Where did we fall short?
We didn't know what was going on. We didn't know what Putin's game was when he, in the 90s, he was in St. Petersburg for a lot of that. We didn't know, for instance, because we had no agents, that he was active reserve, that he reported to the KGB, and that he was the front man for a coup that occurred in 1999. And it's not complicated. The KGB caught Yeltsin's family stealing money. They took it to a prosecutor. The prosecutor was about ready to put him in jail. And then the KGB filmed the prosecutor with two girls at a sports club. Mm-hmm. And then Putin himself took that clip and put it on TV. The prosecution end, Yeltsin said, hey, these guys saved me. And they're everywhere.
Yeah.
He knew about the fourth man, and they've got the fourth man. You know, they've got Washington wired. They're everywhere. So, all right, I'm going to join the program. So 1999, he resigns and appoints Putin. It's that simple. And so what we have today is the deep state in Russia run by the KGB. I mean, there's no other way. This isn't mythology. I mean, you look at every single position, it's ex-KGB, from oil companies to titanium, everything is KGB, and it's not an accident, and it's a system that was imposed on Russia. So we missed the 1999 coup because of the moles. We had no inside look into the KGB, what was going on. I compare it in some fashion to Pearl Harbor, but
yeah,
it's not the greatest comparison.
Yeah. It took us by surprise, right? That's basically
a total surprise. Yeah. The ambassador told me at the time to Moscow, our ambassador said, look, I get better information from taxi drivers than I do the CIA. And everybody at the National, I've been in touch with all these people, said there was nothing out of the CIA.
I only have you for a couple more minutes, but when you look at Russia's invasion of Ukraine, like, what are the thoughts that come to you?
Well, what scares me is that Putin is just going to continue to bombard Ukraine until it no longer exists as a country. And as of today, that's what he's doing. He doesn't care about the losses, you know, the conscripts dying or the money. No. I mean, he could win this, you know, cutting off grain, cutting off gas, cutting off oil. He's going to push American elections the way he wants.
Yep.
And there's going to be the chances is the Democrats are just going to get creamed. I do believe that. And then in 2024, if this continues, inflation, recession, whatever, Biden and the Democrats are out. And so he gets a government that he thinks is more sympathetic, that'll pull out of NATO. So
it's so interesting that all this is going on. Like, I just don't, I feel so blessed to be able to like talk to people like you about this, because there's so many things that are happening as we go about our daily life. We may get little bits and pieces, but you kind of have to really search it out to be able to find the book is like, is such an eye opener to be able to do that. So do you think that Russia has more that we haven't seen yet? Because a lot of people are like, well, we see what their military looks like, you know, it's taking this long to invade Ukraine. Do you think there's something else, an undercurrent that we haven't seen?
No, I don't think, if there's any prospect of a coup in Moscow, it's impossible for us to know. We'll wake up one morning, there'll be a coup, or could he be sick? I don't know. You know, I've seen all that, but I don't trust anything on that. You just have to look what Putin says he's going to do, that he's going to wipe Ukraine from the map. Putin is a fascist of the worst sort, and he despises the Ukrainians. And if he can force all of them into Europe, they'd be fine with him and populate it with Russia. This is a war to the end. And he looks at it as an existential conflict, and it's going to keep going. I just don't see it ending tomorrow. But yeah, I could be wrong.
Before we go, who would you say, who do you see as our biggest threat?
Well, I mean, clearly China is a bigger threat in terms of a capable military and in the Pacific. But the problem is we don't know what the agreement is between Beijing and Moscow. So if they're both at it, we could really be in for it.
Yeah. Fascinating. This book will send you on a journey for sure. Robert Baer, you can get it at your local bookstore, online, everywhere. And for fans who want to reach out to you, are you on social media? Do you have a website?
No, and I'm not social media.
just living an easy life, right?
Well, there's so much craziness on it. It's discouraging a bit.
Well, stay home and write some more books.
Okay, I'll try.
Hey, thank you so much for the conversation. I appreciate your time today.
Thanks.